So, just before I introduce today's panel or hand it over to Bojana, we have to do our daily acknowledgements of our funders, the Canada Council, Ontario Arts Council, Toronto Arts Council, Istituto Cultura Italiano, the Finnish Arts Council, Pro Helvetia. Those are the main ones. Acknowledge our co-sponsors, so Nekav and Ruin Garanda, Neutral Ground, who sponsored Gary's appearance at the festival. They're based in Regina, and of course, our longtime co-partner, Varro Performance Arts Center. So today's, we want to acknowledge all our fabulous volunteers who have just been, thrown into any situation. One minute they're moving, walls, the next minute they're cutting vegetables, and then 5 minutes later they're doing some delicate little, thing with their eyes. So we depend a lot of them, and they've been really fantastic. So I want to just acknowledge all of them. Thank you. Our bloggers, which if you've been reading along on the festival website, the festival blog space, they're doing a fantastic job of giving an impression of all the stuff either you haven't seen or that you want another perspective on. So I highly, highly recommend that you check out the blog on a daily basis. It seems to be updated at any time of day or night. And of course our fabulous documenters. The artists in particular will appreciate afterwards when they have their video and photos, but you can also see some of Henry Chan's photography on the blog pages, so you can also get a visual image, not just written impressions. Okay, the Toronto Performance Art Collective is, for the people who put it on, Bojana Videkanic, which I'm going going to hand it over to in just a minute. Tanya Mars, Adam Hurst, Anyomi Chung, Shannon Cochran, Johanna Householder. Who am I forgetting today? I said Adam.
Yourself.
And me. Hopefully that's everybody.
One other.
I said Annie.
Francisco Fernando.
Yes. So, anyways,
it's the punishment for
not. We're the crazy collective that brings this to all of you, and we're very happy. Now, I'm going to hand this over to Bojana Videkanic, our newest collective member, who's moderating today's event. It's all yours, Bojana.
Thank you.
Go ahead.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone, for being here. I'm going to try to moderate the discussion with some questions. So I've written them down. I don't want to go through them all in this session. I'll go by first introducing everyone on the panel, and then we'll go into sort of trying to figure out how architecture slash space works with and against and for performance artists. So the panel today is called Approaching Architecture, and our panelists are in various ways addressed that or worked with architecture. We had a little powwow before we come out to the panel, and we've kind of discussed this word architecture and what it means, and it has its very specific history and weight. So we kind of figured that maybe we like space better, but we can interchange it. Some of the questions will have to do with space more, and some outside of architecture. So I would like to start by introducing Anya Liftig, who has come to us from the US. Her work has been featured at Tate Modern, Highways Performance Space, Exit Art, Mountain Performance Art in Berlin, and many other international and national venues. She's a graduate of Yale University and Georgia State University, and has had various residencies in the United States and elsewhere. And her work, I'm not going to try I'm going to try to go into your book. We'll discuss it as we go in the panel. I'll just sort of mention some of the bio. The next person that I will introduce is Gary Barrow, who's a curator, visual artist, and production designer. He's based in Regina, Saskatchewan. He has exhibited his installations across Canada and his performances, and he has worked in different, or presented at different performance art festivals. He's established the Queer City Cinema in 1996, so he is the director of the festival and organizing that in Regina. And last but not least is Christian Bujold. He's a performance artist based in Montreal. He has finished his master's degree at UCAM, University of Quebec at Montreal in 2011. He is an administrator for the Artist Center of Moderator, and also works as a board member of the International Performance Art Festival, Viva Art Action. He's been traveling around the world, nationally and internationally, and presenting his work. So all three of our presenters have actually presented their work, Christian and Anya yesterday, and Gary at the opening on the opening night. So, now that we have gone through the introductions, so my first sort of caveat was that we will not only talk about architecture, but think about the space. And I was trying to figure out how to structure the panel, because I was given the topic, so I was like, what do I do? How do I do this? Like, what do I ask them? And then I remembered that some years ago I read this book by Bachelor on space, and I was very interested in sort of my brain started working, and I was sort of getting interested in all these interesting things that he was mentioning about space. So some of that will come up. So the first question that I would like to pose for our panel is, how do each of you approach architecture for space, and how does that influence how you modify, adjust, or completely change your performances? So maybe Carrie, because you
wasn't
there, so I'll give you the time to adjust.
Well, I actually have a question
to
you.
Okay.
Can I ask you about the
story
for the collective? Where did the idea of addressing the theme of architecture? Was it based on our work, or was it just a re-randomly sort of?
I should answer this. Francisco and I are the ones who kind of put together the panels. You know, we know most of the artist's work to some degree, obviously. Reading through everybody's statements, sort of thinking about what topics would we like to address. Architecture seemed to be one that I think we did pull it out of. To some extent, we were talking about it, and we thought, yeah, definitely, that's one of the themes going on here. So that's how we ended up with that.
You know, part of the reason I asked is that my background's in architecture, so I thought it would be a great way to talk about some of my academic training. But I won't do that. I'll just say that I went to architecture school, so. My dad was an architect, so there's this thing that has been in my life for ever, I guess. So I have an affinity for space and architecture, and my visual artwork indirectly or directly addresses architecture, but more to do with aspects of how architecture separates public and private. So, ultimately in a domestic sense, so some of the installation work I've done has addressed things like the actual very physical threshold between the domestic house and the exterior. And this is also related to queer identities as well, starting with this private-public aspect, some kind of under the radar, so to speak, or not. And so, in terms of the performance that I did, skipping straight to the performance I did today, I think there's still been some ideas about the private public, the fact that I'm separated visually from the audience that can't see me. My identity is absent for the most part. And also, my form, my bodily form is abstracted through the use of these interior spaces, which act as devices to, I guess, they become a type of architecture and or space. So with that, I'll be jumping in later.
Can I follow up?
Yeah.
Maybe more of an observation is when Paul and I were standing looking at you inside the space that you've created inside these forms, it was interesting to see how they moved from being sort of internal organs, being phallic, to being something that's architectural. Right? And so, and it was very interesting to see how you could at one point see the body, and then when you kind of make these movements down, when you I guess when you bend inside it and pull down, it not only flops, but it seems like there's nothing inside. Like there's no body inside. So it's sort of the space eats you up. And it becomes sort of animal-like, almost, sort of like eating itself up. So it's interesting to see how the space that you were creating through these shapes, through the material, moving and changing as you were moving inside.
The other thing I was wanting to mention was, I guess, context and space in terms of the space versus the space I used at Live in Vancouver last year, which is a storefront space where public weren't allowed. They didn't enter the space, so they viewed through windows, which adds yet another layer of separation from the public, I guess. And you know, this space, it's just more, what I'm trying to address right here is how performance spaces that we go to when we go to the performance festival, we don't exactly know where we're going to be necessarily, and that can change so much how we respond to the space. And I mean, I didn't know how the public would navigate this room in terms of do they surround, do they stay there? Would I do? How would I navigate this space? So in Live it was somewhat different. There I didn't have to think about how the audience was in the space.
Well, I guess I would say that in terms of my relationship to architecture and my work, I think probably the thing that has informed what I do the most is, well, when I enrolled at Yale, I don't know, I'm sure some of you have seen pictures of it. You've seen certain pictures, which are the ones with the very traditional kind of looking buildings that were actually built in the 1930s and are have like fake acid on the wall to make it look like really like a faux Oxford, right? And so when you enroll there, you're randomly selected for one of 12 colleges. 10 of them are these old sort of beautiful, you know, buildings, fake old, but still beautiful buildings. And two of them were known as the ugly ones. And so I was like, oh, please don't let me get into the ugly ones. Well, of course the letter comes and it says, you know, basically welcome to ugly college. And those are ones that are known as, like, they'll say that they, you know, they were like peanut brittle, or they were just, you know, rain, they were like terribly aggressive looking. But they were designed by Eero Saarinen, and I had no idea who Eero Saarinen was as a, you know, when I read that. And one of the interesting things was, as a sophomore, you start to live in these spaces, none of the rooms have right angles, right? Which is incredibly frustrating. Although you have a single and you have a room to yourself, it's incredibly frustrating to try to put a chair or like a bookshelf anywhere, right? And so at first there was this experience of being like, what the hell is going on here? And who gave this man money to build this stuff? And also outside of my window was a, this is how naive I was, there was a sculpture called Lipstick Ascending on Caterpillar Tracks by Klaus Altenburg. And Vincent Scully, who is a famous architecture critic, had been the person who sort of got Saarinen and Oldenburg to build, to put this college there. And once I started living in it, I was very curious about it. And I was sort of snooping around being like, what, was there some concept that went into this building? Like, why on earth would you do this? And each, I should also mention, each building, each room had huge desks with built-in bookcases, right? Massive. And it was really interesting to read about it because Saarinen and Scully come up with the idea that when you are in college, that it's really about learning your own individual angles and learning your own sort of individual ways of moving through education. And in every room in the traditional Yale buildings, they have these huge fireplaces from, you know, that were also fake because by the time they built the buildings, nobody actually needed fireplaces anymore. But, so they had decided that that was really the hearth, and they wanted to make the hearth in these rooms the sort of place where the education took place, and to make it a very sort of cozy center of the space. And so, reading about Saarinen, and reading about Scully, and reading also about the placement of this massive, phallic, super modern sculpture that resided right outside so every person could see it, was probably some of my first introduction to conceptual art, certainly conceptual architecture. And it was an incredible experience for 3 years to get to live in a space like that, which was both frustrating, which certainly like navigating one's education and one's personality, one's identity is certainly frustrating, but also the way that each person negotiated the space was different and like learned from that. So I think that that really, and that was the period of time in which I became interested in visual art making. And I think that that, these days, you know, certainly like the piece I did last night, there's a tent. These days, I mean, I think of architecture as form. I guess that's sort of when I think about what is art in my work, that there is a formal aspect to it. And that means that there are some things that repeat themselves, or there are some symbols that, or there are threads that continue to be sort of lightly pulled through the work. And in particular, the piece that I did last night is part of a new way of, or a more recent way of trying to solve some of the problems that you're talking about, which is like going into different spaces. So I wanted to create, these face ballets, these sort of, my background is in dance, and my body is now, excuse me, way too old and decrepit to dance with any, you know, sort of skill, really. and so I wanted to concentrate on what types of movements I could do that were very, you know, and what could I do, and I was thinking about, like, Yvonne Renier has this one piece when she was in the 60s, she was in a hospital bed in Europe, and it's her hand, and it's just 5 minutes of her hand going like this. And it's terribly boring to watch, but it's very interesting, the idea. And so I was wanting to kind of come up with a studio that would roughly be in proportion if my body was my face, and the tent would be the studio. And also to be able to make it portable so that, you know, in situations where everybody's working at once, which is often a situation that I encounter, there would be a little bit of privacy, but still be able to be part of the whole. And so I guess I've started to use that as sort of a way of, as a structure and a space that is very much, I think, a metaphor for the way I feel as a human being, that I want to be part of what's out there, but I kind of can't get out of here. So that's what I would say.
So looking at Gary's nodding, because I think that we had some couple of weeks ago, we had this discussion about forming inside something, and how that creates a kind of a safety zone where in which you can operate and direct yourself, especially if you're shy or if you feel like, well, I don't want to interact with people, I just want to kind of present something and then see how they come up. So it's kind of interesting to see both of you talking about this small space. So I'm just going to go to Christian and see what
I'm interested in architectures, architecture in a really non-academic way, in a really instinctive, with a really instinctive approach. I'm not a specialist of theory or things. I'm more interested about some elements of psychology that act upon my body and the body of everyone during a performance within a certain space. And I don't know how to put it in order, but that's been amazing. When I'm planning a performance, I mean I can't plan a performance before I enter the space. I have to know how that space will happen. I have to know how the space regulates behaviors and regulates any kind of physical and intellectual directions or power. So this is really important. So I played some more relevant pieces. I have a project that I didn't do it with another performer, just a friend of mine. We had that piece where we have been put in an empty room we haven't seen before. We had that, we were blindfolded and deaf. And the plan was to search for each other in that space. But there were columns and stairs and things. So you could just walk in that space for 3 hours searching for it. So that's a relevant example of how the architecture act upon a relation towards two persons towards a certain restraints that we have established. And I think that for me, the architecture of the way is really a matter of understanding how something has an authority on the body, or gets to control, and how we have a preconception about that space that changes our behaviors towards each other, towards the action. So it's more about psychological use that is inside specific spaces. So
already that you come into when you enter architecture or when you live in architecture. So would you consider that an impediment, restriction, and if it is, how do you work against it? Do you work against it? Do you work with it? Yeah, in a venue or in a venue outside. Is that a conscious decision as well?
It could be a conscious decision, but I think that there's nothing if there's no restraints at some point. Everything is there's nothing that does if there's no restraints. So you cannot think in content freedom. I think it's impossible. So it's not a matter of is that authority or that those restraints are bad or good. It's just a matter that it acts upon the action. And it can be very formal. And with that same project, with the performance, with my friend, we had just that performance where we used to have it outside the corner of the building, and we were each one of us were restricted to stay on the border of the building, going towards the corner or backwards in the end, trying to figure out. Working a bit like magnets, am I feeling attracted to that person, so I'm going towards the corner, am I feeling repulsed, so I'm going back. And you had to figure out where was the position of the time. It works in a very formal way, and so it doesn't, the power there was that restraint of keeping that those lines and that corner in a really mathematical way. That architecture was baseline of how the movement was planned. And I think it's important, but I don't know if it's relevant anymore. I can't remember that.
I think it is because what you're pointing to is the restriction of architecture, but your action reveals it. Right? By your action, it kind of brings it up to the surface.
My point was about it's not always on for me in a critical way.
It doesn't. Yeah.
It's not political, but everything is. But it's not well, you know what I mean.
Actually, a good entry point to what I was going
to
say.
I
think at times I've tried to, in various venues, when you do, when you go and perform in a lot of places, you perform in some weird, places, right? So, you perform, just seeing rapid fire, terrifying, scary, unsafe places. But I think that, at different points I've tried to negotiate the authority of the space in different ways. So particularly, if it's a black box or it's something that's very sort of traditional, I'm sort of in a phase now where I want to flip around or find the thing that can't really find some way to subvert it just a little bit. At various points, I've tried to really work with it and to sort of make it look beautiful and gorgeous. Other times, I've tried to insert myself in some sort of peculiar way. So as I was looking and thinking about your question, this room, how would I work? I might be, hanging up there, in the corner, Or using some part of the space that seems less, behind those pipes, or using something that calls attention to the architecture, but also is sort of subversive in a way that it's not the way that you expect to see performance. Although certainly many people also do that. And I guess to me, the idea of the authority of the architecture, there's a piece I did that I think probably speaks to this the most, which is when Marina Romovic did her retrospective, Artist is Present, she at MoMA, she was in the huge atrium there, and that atrium to me was and is still this sort of massive space of authority. It's if you're in that space, you are the art authority. The art gods are giving you, and the architectural gods are giving you, space. Not only because it's in the Museum of Modern Art, but because it's 5 stories tall at an empty atrium in prime Manhattan real estate. And so if you think about the cost of that empty space, it's actually you are being conveyed as this is valuable. And so Marina, Marina's act was very incredible in that she was, quote unquote, just sitting there, right? And I went to the museum rather early on in the exhibition, dressed like her and sat across from her all day. And I wanted to sort of play within the very specific rules that she had set up for that piece. And I wanted to be inside of those rules, but just on the edge of them, and just pushing the boundaries. So nobody said, you can't dress a certain way. Nobody said, and she was very specific, she said, you can't stay there all day. You can't fall asleep, you can't talk to her, you have to maintain eye contact, all these different things you have to do. So just sort of staying within the boundary But moreover, there was at that time this sense that, you know, here in, within the relationship of the art relationship, particularly I would say a female to female art relationship and dealing with like a lineage and heritage, that this is this sort of uber person, right? And I'm not uber. And so and I would like come in my like, you know, just, like shitty outfit and like, you know, crappy wig and try to position myself in a position of that looks equal and democratic, but is clearly not. And so playing with that idea of what has value and what doesn't. And also the interesting thing to me was that the underneath, directly underneath this part of the atrium where she was in the center, is where the cash registers for the MoMA are. And MoMA is, you know, incredibly expensive. I think at the time it was 20, now it's 25. Mm-hmm. And I still have my student pass, so I just go in. But you could, I mean, I had a certain point, once I kind of was in that space for a while, I could really feel this sort of current of, like, hear the sort of murmur of money coming and the, like, ka-ching, ka-ching, ka-ching. And so I wanted to be in that space and to I thought it was, in my own little, like, way, it was important for me to do it. It was kind of like, me, you know? And so that I guess, is that political architecture space.
And I was just admitted here to follow up on that. What you said in your introduction about the threshold and the kind of the queer body,
yeah,
the public and the private, how that could sort of latch on to
that. This thing of boundary and how actually I think of public space or space that's not held within architecture or building as having authority that there's a vulnerability outside of structure that there's there's safety within being inside, specifically a domestic context, because you can make that space your space, that space physically and otherwise. It's where you yourself, but also in a more sort of conceptual way, I guess it's about addressing the queer identity thing, where you can again be comfortable and safe, and, but also be separated as well. So the authority is kind of reversed for me in terms of that kind of architecture for public spaces and not safe space. And within the performance I did, these tubes, whatever you want to call them, there is this safety and there's this separation and there's this place of the inside and out, but also removal. And I guess it speaks to my own self.
And have you ever done it outside? Like, would you ever consider it if you haven't?
I did it outside in the park just as a and yeah, I do outside.
And how would that change it? I mean, how would that, when
right,
you're outside
right,
of
yeah,
the safety zone of the performing space, how would it change it?
Well, then you're more, then it's, context is identifiable. It's if you come upon it, you can have signs that say, you know, such a performance art festival. And my name, but I mean, if it's just left to be found, there's issues of safety,
yes,
issues of heckling, that might be a good thing.
Has ever done it? Has that happened?
No.
Okay.
Maybe it has. So yeah, I mean, it's not public space. mean, this is public space too, but it's interior public space. So yeah, I think it changes everything.
Yeah, I know how it's relevant, but I was thinking about what you said and what you said about hearing this and the fact that you place the piece outside and you change every aspect of the world. And it brought the, we have that architecture, which is physical, and we got that architecture, which is the architecture of a piece in itself, in terms of structure. And I don't know if it's really, I don't know if it's a good idea, I don't know where it goes, but being inside that structure and challenging. So playing a way that the architecture of the piece itself might fall or transform or be something different. But I think that architecture plays in that kind of way as a structure of the piece itself. And I think it's interesting because
there's a connection there.
There's a connection there because even you said that in any place you are, you can transform that space just by being there.
So how do you delineate the architecture of your piece? How do you build it? How do you decide how big it's going to be? Because there's obviously there are certain things that you can do, like physical things, the piece, but then there's also invisible things, right? The power of empty space and your own body within the space and how it creates through that relationship. Architecture. So how is your body architecture? I guess that's what I want to.
There's a lot of there's a lot of really technical ways that just how to enter the performance, how to plan to end it, how to plan the public to be seated around you or be standing or whatever. So that these are all elements that build the structure, the inner structure of the performance and that act upon. And I see them as structural elements, but as performative elements here. So it's something that is part of the performance itself. So when I get someone to be in the performance, I don't wish to instrumentalize that person. I wish I don't instrumentalize that person. I wish I brought up that idea of structure the element of surprise or danger or risk that I put upon myself when I'm in performance. I don't know if you guys were there for the performance yesterday, but I had certain point, I had certain dots I didn't know how to kind of force, so that almost there was nothing in terms of a narrative unfolding. So that's all part of you're building something, you're building the architecture in a live way.
I think that idea of public space, I mean, I've performed in public, I've performed in, parks and, and then also in festivals that are deliberately in public space, or certainly have been heckled quite a bit, which is distracting but also very interesting sometimes. But it is sometimes like what's cool about it is that I did this one piece with a friend of mine it was called A Boring Appetite, where we had these white chocolate babies that we made. And basically we had all the sort of strappings of the, New York mommies. But we would take out our babies and we would eat them. we did this on the High Line and then we walked across 14th Street. And on the High Line, it's a very touristy area, so the people who were not American, I would say, actually sort of received this better, right? Because they're like, pizza and a sandwich. Like, you know, I'm just very, you know, I'm just very rude. But also, you know, want to know and want to get involved.
If the baby's safe.
Yeah, if the baby's safe, or, you know, and then you see sort of, like, the women who live in the area who are like, gosh, would be like, you know, and then, of course, you'd see women pushing real babies and
this one is in deep postpartum.
Yes. and so we walked, one of the days we did it, we walked across 14th Street, or doing Entire Street, to Union Square Park, where there happened to be a, I forget what the actual name of it was, but basically it was a protest by women about rape, right? And about violence against women. And we were supposed to, at the end of this piece, go into the center of the park. And there were women, you know, wearing, you know, carrying signs and topless and like, you know, and what went from being this sort of critique, right, in one context that we had thought out and we knew what was happening, we walked into the park and then there was something new, right? And we weren't really talking to each other during the piece other than in our sort of guises. But both of us recognized that, like, all in a lot of it, there was a lot of abortion signs and things like that. And both of us recognized that what we were doing suddenly changed just by the context of where we were and where we were surrounded, and that the way that it could be read was very different. And it had an impact on the performance because it became like, oh, we don't want to do this, maybe. And so that, I think, is interesting, and it's definitely one of the things that occurs when you're working in public, is that you have to be really improvisational, and you have to really, like, prepare to deal with everything on the fly, and deal with cops, particularly when you're working with cops, what are you doing? But I think that to answer the specific question that I think I sort of remember what it was that you asked, was I did a piece after this, where it was in Atlanta, which is the city I lived in for a while, and there, it was a big, when I say commission, it was something that was planned, right? An organization gave me some money for it. And there was a tremendous permitting process. And part of the permitting process and going in front of community boards to get this to happen was that it had to be comprehensible to the general public what the project was. And it was about, well, that's a challenge for me. and so it was even more challenging to try to explain to other people who are lay art people what was going on. And so it was about, the piece was essentially, when I was asked what I wanted to do, I wanted to build a gigantic barricade, like Les Mis kind of style, and to cover it with peanut butter and to crawl through it, like, and to try to surmount this thing. And the reason why I had wanted to do this was because the organization asked me, what is like something that you've always wanted to do? And so I just said, the thing I always wanted to do, because I knew it would never happen, right? Like, I was like, who's gonna fund that, right? Well, I don't know what they were smoking that day. They were like, that sounds like a cool idea. And I'm like, and so again, I had to work backwards to kind of justify or dig into my own consciousness about why I want to do this and how am I going to build an architecture of context around it, and then also deal with the very specific context that Atlanta, as a city that claims to be the city that's too busy to hate, but actually has plenty of time to hate, right? How to deal with that in that context. And I actually have to say that the piece, you know, we use this word failure, right? Or like, I make a big word about failure. In retrospect, 2 years on, the piece was a colossal failure. It was a spectacular, amazing disaster. And it's amazing to me it happened. And part of it was that it was built on this very frail conceptual architecture, right? But it was also extremely architectural in the relied on this design, right? And I was unable to convey, because I'm not really a craftsperson, right? I would say, you know, to my technical team, I'd be like, build it like this, here's a photo, build it like this, you know, and not be able to actually do anything myself to be like, no, I actually want it like that, or to, and I didn't have the language to do it. And I just kind of kept like, you know, being like, well, could it be more like this, more like that? And so when the piece was done, and it actually did have 1,100 pounds of, there were 17 volunteers who put 1,100 pounds of not fit for human consumption peanut butter on this piece in the middle of the summer. the piece, and I started to climb it, right? Well, I had climbed it before, the night before, and I was okay. I recognized that there was some danger in this structure. It basically ended up looking like a psychotic sort of playground and like things jutting like this, and it was ended up being made out of a lot of trash and all this stuff. I kept wanting it bigger and bigger and bigger and scarier and scarier and scarier. And well, when you put peanut butter on something, I should also mention, I was blindfolded and bound. I have one little claw hand. I didn't have a helmet on, but like I have one little claw hand in which to climb. And as I started that piece, you know, I've always been really into this, you know, a lot of the early pieces had involved some type of physical danger or some type of risk or something, you know, like looking at cactus or something that like was dumb. And as I started to do it, I was like, dude, fuck yourself. And my husband was in the audience, and all of a sudden, you know, I was climbing this live stream, all these people, and I'm climbing blindfolded 16 feet into the air, and I don't know where I'm going. And I get up to what I think is up there, and I'm sitting there, and I'm sort of in this performance mode, but then it occurs to me, like, you could actually kill yourself. Responsible for this. It's not like you could blame it on anybody else. Like, this started as a figment of your imagination, and somehow through some screwed up manner, it became real. And it may be the thing that like physically kills you. And in front of all of these people. And it could be so ridiculous. I mean, what would you say? It's like a freak accident?
So irreverent or so like, you know,
Jewish Yankee girl flies in and, you know, screws up this area and, you know, dies and so that was a very, and that was all part of that failure, I think. And in retrospect, it's you know, it happened.
So this idea of the symbolic architecture versus structural space versus structure of the performance, maybe that's something that we can talk about. Gary, maybe you can talk a little bit about your earlier performance with the chicken bar. Was it chicken bar? Was that
chicken
egg? Chicken egg, that's right.
Which, you know, it actually wasn't a performance, but it very well could have been.
Yeah.
I mean, the visual work artwork had done previous to the performance, which is newer to me, was a great performance. Sorry, what was the question?
Symbolic architecture versus structure versus body.
Well, I'll just tell you what it was about. it was a series of photographs that were produced in a hotel in Regina. So it was this scuzzy hotel. And again, this linked this relationship with domestic or private space. And I tarred and feathered myself in 12 colors of feathers. So there's just the same amount of humiliation and also play. But more or less the scenarios were really inane, everyday life situations answering themselves. Really kind of uneventful things to just the sort of end of right away, I guess.
If you were doing all these actions within the hotel,
yeah, that's right. And with being photographed, of course. So it's a series of photographs.
But you were performing for them?
Yeah, I guess I was performing for the situation. It was a minus 50 day in January, and the hotel wasn't heated, and I had shaved my whole body, and was putting on the tar, the tar mixture, which was black date and molasses, with a roller, and I had help. But it was painful, but I guess it maybe lent itself to the project in that sense. But
because I'm very interested in this idea that you constantly bring up of the private and public and the hiding and revealing oneself through space and kind of, you know, the idea of shy, being shy and then being embarrassed,
right.
Also being embarrassed by other people, and so that kind of negotiation or this tension that you seem to have in your work.
Yeah, I mean, the performance I did, I mean, performance is a newer thing for me, so I'm not used to presenting myself as the work. And I think this piece addressed that in a way that I'm not exactly comfortable to admit to, but it was this way to disappear from the public, and but also free to address those tensions, I guess. I've also done some other work that is about necessarily architectural, but it was a fictitious identification system for a nation made of gay white men called Canada. And so there was all these national costume sport, which was the national animal was the poodle, the national dress was a dress covered in red AIDS ribbons, and wrestling. So that, again, large-scale photographs and this sort of performance. form of element I use myself again. It's so much easier to use yourself than try and find someone to do crazy, cheaper and crazy and silly things. So that was a way to sort of subvert a system or a, want to say, something to do with architecture, I guess, but maybe this thing about it working.
Christian, I wanted to ask you, because we were talking earlier about this idea of objects and bodies in space and how you see architecture not just what you create as architecture of your piece, but also how you work with people. You mentioned a little bit about it, but I'm interested in terms of last night's performance. When I was watching it, it was very clear that the entirety of the room was echoing, and then people's bodies were responding to sound. So I was interested in how you construct that and how you see.
I'm not sure if I constructed it. I think I triggered it. Mm-hmm. It's a bit different, but yeah, I mean, the space was really filled with that sound, that really deep sound that did react to the bodies that were there with some kind of resonance. So that's how I'm triggering somewhat of reactiveness between that guitar thing and that other thing and that resonance. So I had a reflection about how to densify that space, how to see it as a block of sound, as a block of a vibration that would have everybody to be engaged or in the piece. And I don't control the science of that. I don't know exactly why or what. I mean, I'm not a specialist with sounds or recording or vibration. I mean, someone could just really have better answers than me there. But I noticed that there was different things happening depending on how many people were in the room. On that tuning part at the beginning, I had already done it before, so the thing was already tuned. And it didn't work at all with the public inside, so I had to pump up the volume pretty much to have the same density that I had before.
Because of bodies.
Yeah, but this is the only thing that changed, so I believe that this would be the answer. And we all acted like resonance cages or something. So,
mufflers.
What?
Mufflers.
Yeah, that's it. So I had to tune in more, and that's how, I mean, that's how it has structured itself. With that, just the thing I triggered. So it's really more about experience or something that comes up rather than a structure like one that I want to show. It's something that just happened, and this is how I work. I plan things and let's see what comes up. And is this answering your question?
Yeah, no, it is. I'm mostly also interested in how do you, and I think Gary mentioned something in the beginning that was presenting at Live. He was sort of doubly separated from the audience because he was in the window of a store or when sort of somewhere yeah, where a barrier was there. And then here, when he was in this room, people were around him. So I'm interested also in how you negotiate between the space and the audience, where you imagine the audience to be somewhere, or how do their bodies negotiate or change or
This is really, really, really really important and it's critical for a piece for me to know how to see how people will be or it's the part of control that I have, how it begins. So it's important to me to know how people will sit in the room or the installation was in the center, so I control the fact that you were going to sit around. If I would have put my elements in the installation, you know, it would have been the same. And it's pretty, I had to figure out the channel that made the presentation that night, how she was going to do it. So I could figure out how that begin the performance is really critical for me. Because everything's in the detail. That there's nothing else but details that you figure out. But after starting from that point, and that's what excites me the most about performances.
But there's also details you can't control. So you may have thought last night we would have as many people as the first day. So it would have been very different. You would have had doubled the number of people in that room, and that would have changed it completely in terms of how much room that was for you to walk around.
Yeah, sure. When I say I have to plan those things, because I don't have to plan this for weeks. It can be just a minute before when I first enter the room and saw the word for the first day. I had considered that it might have been people just really close to the setup. But it changed and still the major elements was workplace, the way I figured out. So and it's about architecture at some point. It's about how you organize your installation and things to somewhat control how the people will
just thinking about the duration and what I did, which was 4 hours versus some of the other work, which is 40 minutes.
You could tell me.
And when there's something that's shorter, that when you open the door and the audience enters, it's this packed place for the people who stay for the entire time. Whereas even here, there were times when there was no one in the room. And for 4 hours, which was interesting because that I can see through the mylar somewhat, but I also surveil the room through the ends of these two things to see if there's anyone there or not. Energy is, of course, different when the room's empty. You're kind of at a loss at the moment to be. You continue on because you're not necessarily. Your state of mind is quite altered when you're home, of course, and especially if you're inside these strange spaces. So you're not really just. Kind of going, okay, there's no one in the room, it's shitty, or is this okay, this is interesting, I'll just keep going, is it there people in the room, or does it really matter if there's anyone in the room? And occupying the space for a longer time in terms of this architecture thing is interesting to me, because it sort of broadens this.
You would get used to the space. If you have a word, it's
intimate.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, those questions. I made that performance for an artist that I was performing in a piece. Her name is Anya. And the performance was 6 hours. One person was standing, the other one was lying in the ground for 6 hours. They had to look at that. how that might personally change ways and stuff. And it was the only action you got in space. But you could have 2 hours with anybody entering the room. And then you got those questions about why am I I made that performance 8 times. At the 6th time you've gone through
a range of what you and then it becomes very improper. I mean,
yeah,
because it's just you or you and another collaborator, and it becomes your time in some ways to be with your work alone, which is strange, which is not necessarily the intent, but if it is a longer piece, it happens.
Sure,
inevitably, I guess.
I think that performance is, for me, at its heart, it's about making the private public. And so when you don't have the energy of an audience member, that desire to connect, or that end point of connection, or disconnection, or just feeling something with somebody else is missing. And so it becomes, it just shifts, you know? I think that's at the heart of all performance, is like, why do people stand in front of other people and do stuff, right? Why does, you know, Mariah Carey or, you know, Justin Bieber or why does anybody have the desire to stand in front of people? And because it's a very judgmental, like, you're putting yourself in an incredibly vulnerable place, right? Like American Idol, like when you see those, you know, or Canadian Idol or whatever, you see the contestants, what is that desire? Is it, I mean, it's always for fame, for variety, for appreciation, for attention, for validation. But there is something about the public that completes things. And I think it goes to a very, very primitive place of wanting to be accepted.
Sorry, there's something about being in a room filled with people and that energy. It was interesting to see yesterday people leaving, the sound. So there is this kind of charge, right, that you have. There's a charge that you feel when you're performing, but there's also the charge inside of space that happens during the performance that also, I think, does up to what you need to connect up to people. I'm just being cognizant of time, and I would like to open the questions to the audience. So I would like to ask if you have further questions or something that we haven't touched upon at all.
So it sort of follows on what you were saying just a moment ago, Anya. You know, in addition to the technological aperture of the cameras and projection, your tent was open just a little bit so that, you know, from some vantages we could look into the space and not quite see there was continuity. And when you closed the performance, you first turned off the camera. But then the second thing that happened, it may just have been pragmatic, because you closed the zip and sort of broke off that connection or flow.
Do you want?
Well, I was just curious, you know, how exactly.
Well, I mean, that's one of those cases where I could sit in front of you and be like, well, you know, I did this deliberately. It's the secret we all know. You're also, in your performance, you're negotiating a lot of different things, and for me, technology makes me really nervous, so negotiating, like, oh my god, is the thing still working, is it this, is it that, you're doing all of that and you're managing it, and then you're also doing the thing. So, and I really was firm that I wanted to close the tent as the end of the piece, and I didn't want to, because so much of that is about, and that the idea of seeing the slice of it was that I wanted there to be something that you couldn't see. You couldn't really see, right? But you could see a different perspective of what was happening in the camera, so it was mediated, right? But what was happening was inside here, right? And so that was another level of not being able to see what was happening. And then when the various objects would come out, it was like a sort of, you know, revelation. And then once you saw the first object, it was like, oh, I know there might be something else coming out. What's that going to be? But I wanted to continue, I wanted to seal that off at the end, and I didn't want to kind of like pop that by coming out and being like, So I was like, okay, what do I do? How do I shut it off? That was the impulse, was just the practical part of finishing and making sure that I shut the thing and was the zipper going to work.
And did you wait until the room cleared to emerge?
Pretty much. I mean, because some people hung out, and it was hard for me to tell, like, well, is everybody gone? Is not everybody gone? Well, pretty much, yeah. And, yeah. I think, yeah. Sorry.
This may be too big a question, but I was just thinking when Mary was talking about the media.
is to make the what I see in my head which I recognize as a fiction, but is very real in my head, to give it some type of life of its own. And as Paul said, to make it real. So it is actually tangible. But these relationships are things that only exist in my head. So there are pieces I mean, I can talk about a lot of pieces, but there is a piece I do, or I've done it, I no longer do it, with a very large salmon, where I make out with the salmon to date and dance with it to David Bowie's Let's Dance. And then I cut it up and I put it in a blender and I drink it. And that is like, that is a complete narrative that played out in my head. And it's in a lot of ways, you know, you can say these things, you know, they are referenced, they refer to things like, and that refers to memories of Dan Aykroyd's Bassomatic, and like things like, you know, that are all these sort of shreds that come together in my head to form something. And yeah, so it's about making that thing a little literal. And also I just think it's about like the idea of like producing the fictional narrative or using this fictional world. It's just about seeing what it feels like. Because in my head I think that I know what it feels like, but what does it actually feel like? And I think that's really much as my motivation to perform is just to find out. Like Jerry Winograd said, well, like why did he was like, why do you photograph? And he was like, photograph to see what things look like photographed. And I think at the time it seemed like he was trying to, you know, not to debate the question, but I think that's very true. Yeah, it's very accurate.
Yeah, so I have a lot of thoughts about this, but and I'll just limit it. I think it's interesting where there's different performances, you know, that we've seen that have a crossover with other media forms. And I'm so glad you keep talking, referencing, you know, drinking a salmon and David Bowie. But I often think about, because some of us were, you know, because the rooms were packed, some of us were in the performance bar, right? Terrence mentioned this thing about, you know, so we're watching it yet again at a distance because we still think we can read most of it. So the question is, there are certain pieces that are sort of architecturally self-contained, right? The tenant did that, but there are other pieces that aren't. And I'm not, so then I'm thinking about, okay, whether it's performance art or whether it's some other form of, let's keep the music thing going, right? There's a desire somehow to make, to have, not participation, but in a very strange, you know, in a very strange way. So the participation happens. Just like people were stamping and cheering and eventually singing Happy Birthday, you know, at a certain point in that performance when it began. But my question is, how much in the architecture or the construct of the performance would it allow for certain things to happen, not to create a dangerous space? And we know there are many examples where people aren't supposed to participate and they'll either destroy something or they'll physically attack the performer. But I wonder how many people in the room were willing to sort of say, well, if I'm watching a performance, you know, I can see where it's going, and I'm not going to do this, but I really want to help at this point, and maybe if they haven't thought of this variation, we really need it now because the last variation's gone on too long and we're just sitting here waiting, right? We're getting. So, and that notion is not, it's not about being bored, it's not about bad performance, but it's about the different, just like in visual art, there are these different forms within performance art that require different audience interactions. And is it always clear what that interaction is because of the architecture of the performances rather than the image of the. So are you always sort of clear about what you invite the audience to do or not to do? Is there, do you know where that line is?
I generally just want to, well, as somebody who's had, has intervened in other people's performances, to the everlasting bitterness of the person whose name shall not be mentioned. But Anne has had my performance intervened in. There's a level at which there's an intellectual level where I see like the intervention as that happened to me and that I did as really fascinating and can set in like this other response and sort of in this very meta performance element. There's also a level of like personal, yeah, which is like, hey, what are you doing, right? And being on both sides of that, I think it's just how you respond to it. I think being open to it and like that kind of going on the fly. But I don't know, I never really think I'm waiting. I don't really anticipate somebody intervening or moving on. I guess it's always sort of, I get so into my thing that it's like, there are actually people here, or oh, there's somebody else, or it's a person, they're doing something. Like, I mean, so there's some of that. I don't think that answers your question at all.
I often have urge to intervene, and I have to like really work hard to stop myself, because I'm like, so yeah, did you want to get that?
I had that feeling with Liz's performance, and she was choking in that feeling came very strong to me, and I was ready to get there
I hope nobody because I wanted to go to the end.
Yeah.
Which so not during the performance, but before the performance.
Yeah, because you never know when. We all know about those performances when the artist waits for somebody to intervene, so it's so tricky. It's a tricky line. But I felt it that way.
But how did you negotiate that in your performance?
Me.
Because like you were like people were coming in and then you were like you had the you know the wood between you and you were apologizing to the other person. I didn't hear what you said. Who was it? It was during the second like when you were hugging.
Yeah.
And then you said, oh, I don't want to dismiss you. Something like you said, you were kind of apologetic to the person. You wanted him to go away or something? I can't remember why.
I didn't want to reject him.
Yes, okay.
So I felt kind of bad.
So but you wanted someone else to have a chance?
I don't know, at that point you could have stayed and made a statement out of it. But if something would have gone wrong, the only person I would have blamed is myself, because I opened the door to that. And that's fine, because I was ready to play with it. That's why your question is really, really interesting.
I won't name the person, but a few years ago I saw somebody do this where there was a group of people like this sitting in a circle, and the material of the performance itself consisted of handing out materials of which there was some instructions. And the audience that included people who knew how to perform started performing a new performance out of the material. And the artist got very upset with that. And I was, I'm not blaming the artist, and I won't even say he or she, but I thought, after all this time, surely you must have thought that that was a possibility.
Yeah.
And it's not actually wrecking the piece. It means that people are actually willing to, you've given them this stuff, they're sitting here, you're not going to do anything else, so you need to do something.
I got a similar experience of a performance that didn't go the way you planned. In Australia, the festival was with two girls in the center. I can't remember who they were, whatever. There was like standing still. Place object like cords and all kind of things that you could attach to, and there was a series of objects around the room. It became the room was filled with performers.
So it became very clear that they wanted us to attach them to those specific objects and concentrate on the piece that it didn't turn out at all. They had planned something because there was a group, probably friends and family members, so they really quickly came in and started that setup. So everybody else understood that they wanted us to do it. And it frustrated everyone. So their piece, they have been tied up, and people can cut the links and take the material out the stage and that. Every kind of thing, and then I think they were really frustrated about that, but they're the only to blame, I believe, in that situation. So,
one thing that was very interesting last night was as we entered for Leo Way's performance, and everybody was handing a red kerchief, and before the performance started, perhaps every possible variant of
what to do with it.
Wearing or holding the kerchief was already on display, and then the instructions were set out, and then we were melded as an audience by this intention of the artist, and melded into this structure, this performance, that by following it, we actually...
Well, he is explicitly speaking about architecture. And then the wonderful intuition that Christian had to make the shift between talking about architecture as Ali said before, as a structural, organic entity of some sort, and instead of this, to start thinking of architecture as an organizing principle, as a principle of constructing, and it's, of course, ideology will be included, but I had a wonderful memory to share out with Abramovich. And then, because we're talking about, so I really thank you for the shift, and you tried twice, but let's think of how we organize the piece, how we perceive it as a kind of organic piece of some kind of type. And because we talk about performance art, we deal not just with structure, space, whatever you can think of, angles or pieces of wood. We deal with something that has a kind of emotional capital, something that deals with human space. And so then the whole problem is, how do you organize this? How do you structure mentality? That's why I said, think of our conversation. How can we make sense? Which is, again, I said form. Let's say the form of this collective mentality. And then the whole talk goes into this direction of talking about cloaks and clouds. Or, let's say, I'm referring to Karl Popper's text. And then it's very interesting because I instantly go back to Diana's intuition, which was, I think, quite remarkable to mention the Stone Bachelor at the very beginning. And she didn't mention the name of the book, but the name of the book is The Poetics of Space, The Poetic Response. And I think he's a wonderful example that we can write and structure thought in a poetic way, that we can actually write philosophy and poetry all together, that we can apply legal, we can be perceptive and under homage to our emotional capital, and at the same time make sense. It's a very difficult thing to do, but talking about, and I would here suggest maybe for the sake of our conversation, replacing architecture with architectonics. Then things won't, because architecture is quite misleading. Everyone starts thinking of structure, shape, politics, yeah, politics, very important. I think we can spend hours and hours and hours talking. It's a great area. Thank you to all of you. It was maybe, I can say, the most wonderful artist talk I've ever heard in my life. And I felt maybe. I thought, because again, I think you need to get very important the kindness and the gentleness and the sensitivity of your voice is equally important as element as all the pieces and the structures that you put between you and the people. It's very hard to think about them, but we should. So I'm just trying to push the next conversation more into it. It's a very problematic thing to think about. And moreover, how we make sense of it together, because that's why we're together.
Sure. We haven't even come to the half of the questions. Okay, so unfortunately we'll have to end, but thank you, Vasya, for a wonderful conclusionary thought. So there is still food and coffee, and we can continue the conversation.
And
thank you so much for our panelists.
Thank you.